Bless the Lord. not the one that you would have chosen. When you're at the end of your rope and you're holding on, but feel like you're falling.
This is my first time visiting the Shane conference. It is a wonderful experience. While worshipping, I was almost in tears.
You saw light, then you lost it. But there is still hope. Like the fire in the night. Like the ocean parted wide. Like the grave empty inside. You will see he's still there.
Other companionship, and we look, if we meet friends we are complete, if we look for husband if we are complete, but you know what I have gained from Pastor Jess' explanation, that you know only God can make you complete and whole, and nobody can you know fulfill a woman's desire except God.
Unto God, have your eyes on Him. In the dark world that we are living in, have your gaze on Him. So when we look unto Him, same like Simon Peter did, we will ensure that we would be able to take that bold and courageous steps ahead. So that's my takeaway from this lovely session, that any step that I'm going to take hereafter, I will put my gaze unto the Lord.
You are not depend on yourself, you are depending on the one who is faithful. Say faithful God. God is faithful to bring this to pass in our lives.
I really believe that God has deposited something in each one of us today, and the Holy Spirit will give us the strength to live this out.
Don't deserve it. You take the world. church, let's sing this.
Church, won't you just have that moment right now?
and just declare what you've sung. And I'm seated in heavenly places. I'm crowned with confidence. Come on. Reading out of Isaiah 43. It says, thus says the Lord God, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, that I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. And thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea and a path to the mighty waters. It goes on to say, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. For behold, I will do a new thing. Come on. And it shall spring forth. Don't you even know it? That I will make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Come on, church. Maybe some of you here walked in. You're in a desert type experience, or you're in a wasteland or a wilderness. Today, God wants to reintroduce himself to you and say, he wants you to remember that he is your God. He is your creator. He is your redeemer. He is the Holy One of Israel who made a way before and he will make a way again. And he's going to bring something new, a river in the desert that you're going through. And today, won't you just put on the garment of praise and declare who our God is. Come on. That he is a way maker. He is a miracle worker. He is your promise keeper and he will make a light in the darkness. Come on, church.
Thank you.
Don't feel it, you're working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Never stop, you'll never stop working. Never stop, you'll never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, never stop, you'll never stop working. You'll never stop, you'll never stop. And even when I don't see it, you're working.
I'm so happy to be with you. All of you who love the Lord and say, Jesus is my Lord. Can I hear you say, Jesus is my Lord again? Jesus is my Lord. Once more. Jesus is my Lord. Because my message is only for those who really believe us, right? So that's why I'm saying this out to you. I want to speak to you today about the grace of life. Everything about the Christian life is all about grace. Do you agree? His mercy, His grace, which brings us into His glory, which is just so amazing. This topic on the grace of life has excited me so much that really I can't stop thinking about it. And I pray that every one of us here at the sound of my voice will truly know how to tap into this grace, how to receive more grace into your life so that you will be ever grateful to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's full of grace and truth. Amen. So here it talks about husbands and wives. Together, they are supposed to inherit the grace of life. They are heirs of God. We are all heirs of God. And we are called to inherit the grace of life. And so that our prayers are not hindered, the Bible tells us what to do, especially to the husbands. You may say, this is a ladies' meet. Why are you talking about husbands here? Husbands are very important to us, and we really honor our husbands. We respect our husbands. We love our husbands. We submit ourselves to our husbands, and we, if we are not doing all that, we will soon after this message is over. Amen? Yes, with all their faults, just like Jesus, with all our faults, He loves us. Same way, we want to love each other, husbands and wives, with all our faults, you know, because only the one who can change us is our Lord Jesus Christ. By giving us more grace, we get completely changed. So we want to receive more grace so that we can be changed into the image and likeness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's our calling, actually. So let's fulfill our calling today by looking at what grace is all about. Grace is a divine influence on our heart and its reflection in our lives. If grace can't be seen, you have not yet received grace. You have to display grace in your life. Wherever you go, whether it's your place of work, whether it's your family, whether it is anywhere that you are speaking or living,
grace must be displayed. Grace can be seen. So you should want your life to show that you are a person who's received grace from our Lord Jesus Christ, who's full of grace and truth. It happened so in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 4 and verse 33. Great grace was upon them because they gave witness to the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you want grace to show up in your life, that's all you have to do. Witness to yourself that Jesus is risen from the dead. Grace is poured into your life. Miracles start happening in your life. This I've seen so often every day. I see that when I give witness to the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, grace is poured into my life. And the grace in my life can be seen by others. They will acknowledge this is the grace of the Lord. Whether it's about yourself, your husband, your children, your grandchildren. I have 8 grandchildren and I can proudly say that. Every area of my life is just the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing else but the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, Titus chapter 2 verse 11 to 14 tells us, grace teaches us to be godly, to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, and to live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. So if grace hasn't taught you, you're still ungodly. You're still living in the ways of the world. So all you need to do is turn to the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and say, Lord, teach me to deny ungodliness, deny everything that's wicked, and help me to live that righteous, godly, and holy life before you in the presence of my God and Savior Jesus Christ. Only the Lord knows our hearts and our thoughts. Even our husband and our wives don't know. Only the Lord knows if you're pure and holy. So help us, Lord, to be pure and holy in your sight through the grace that you give us and that the grace that you teach us. Every mountain you face in your life, shout grace, grace to it according to Zechariah 4:7. Meditate on that. I have no time to go into those verses in detail, but really you should just meditate on grace and receive more grace every day for your life to be in that place where you say, I'm saved by grace. Saved not only, the one thing that we say, okay, my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That is wonderful. But every blessing that comes to you and me in the new covenant is by grace through faith. Grace is, again, God's riches at Christ's expense. He paid for it in blood. That's why you and I can receive it by grace through faith. The formula is by grace through faith you are saved. So I want to read out a few verses to you from Ephesians and I will move on with my message into some other things. Everything I'm telling you today is only by grace. You cannot receive it by your works, by all the effort that you put in, all the hard work that you put in. You can't receive grace. It's only the gift of God. Say gift of God. Gift. How many like to receive gifts from God? Yes, this grace is God's gift to you and me. Let me show you that from Ephesians chapter 2. I want to read from 4 to 10. But God, who is rich in mercy, because in the first 4 verses, it's all about our disobedience, all the bad things we have done, all the, we were submit to the air, the power of the air, which is the devil himself. We were children of the devil, but now we are born again and we have Jesus in our heart. Therefore, what has God the Father done for us? I want to show you that. But God, who is rich in mercy, how many of you say, I've received the mercy of the Lord? Mercy of the Lord means you did not get punished for your sins, but you were forgiven for your sins. That which you deserved, God did not give you. God gave you mercy. He says here, he's rich in mercy. Have you received the riches of his mercy? If not, open up your heart and say, Lord, today I want to receive the riches of your mercy. It's very exciting to live in the mercy of the Lord because you will not be punished for your sins. You're forgiven. That's why. Because Jesus was punished for your sins, you are forgiven. We must always remember the cost and the price that Jesus paid for us to invoke love in our hearts to love our Lord Jesus Christ even more. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ by grace ye are saved. So who are we? We are quickened people. We have been raised up again. You know, today when we were worshiping, these verses and these thoughts came to our mind that we were raised together with Christ and made to sit in heavenly places in Christ. What a place to sit in, right? So, and hath raised us up together and made us sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Underline in Christ Jesus in your heart. Where are you? You are in Christ Jesus. You're not outside Christ. You're in Christ Jesus. So if you take your place in Christ, you are victorious. If you don't take your place in Christ, you will be a loser. So here is the good news that in the ages to come, now 2,000 years have passed. We are in that ages to come. What is God going to show you? He might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Jesus Christ. Because God is showing his kindness towards Jesus, we are receiving the exceedingly great grace. All of us must open our heart for this and say, Lord, I want the exceeding riches of your grace to be seen in my life. I want the exceed. You know, the word itself is explanatory. It tells you how great this grace is. It is so rich that you should say, I want it, Lord. I want the exceeding riches of your grace to be seen in me. And what is the reason? The reason is God is being kind to Jesus. Now we are in Christ. So God is so kind to Jesus that he gives us this exceedingly great grace. Wow. For by grace you are saved through faith. That's why I said by grace through faith is every other blessing also. And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Wow. All our pride goes down the drain. It's not our education, it's not our jobs, it's not anything we've done or not done. Or not done. So many things we've not done. We have sins of commission and omission. But here is great grace waiting to be manifested in our life. If you take it as a gift from the Lord, not because of my works, but Lord, your works, I open my heart for your grace that every enemy of my soul is under my feet because I'm seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Are you excited? Yes, this should bring excitement. Besides, you know, God is such a good father. If we have been good parents and grandparents, I don't know how many of you are grandparents like me, but if your parents and grandparents, before the baby comes itself, you have prepared everything that the baby would ever require. Yes or no? What about God? Do you think God is better than us or worse than us? He's given us everything in the form of promises. Say promises. In the form of promises, God has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness, it says in 2 Peter 1, 1 to 4. I ask you to read it and see for yourself. You know, grace and peace is multiplied to you. If you know who God is and who Jesus is, the more I know God, the more I reverence him, the more I worship him, the more I love him, and the more I know who he is, he's given me his righteousness and he wants his grace and peace. Grace and peace are the greatest thing that you can receive from God after mercy. And it says here in 2 Peter 1, 2, that grace and peace be multiplied to you and me through the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. How well do you know our Lord? The more you know him, the more grace and peace is multiplied in your life. How amazing is that? And then he goes on to say, everything, say everything. Everything you and I need, whatever you need today, you need health, you need wealth, you need happiness, you need peace, you need joy, you need love, you need whatever you need from the Lord, it's available to you in the form of promises. So we need to spend time with the Word of God to see where is the seed that I can collect the seed and plant it in my heart, because seeds grow in your heart. Your heart is good ground if it's washed by the blood of Jesus. And then you just believe this word is going to produce a tree and it's going to produce fruit. Every word that you pick up from the word of God and plant it in your heart, it's going to produce fruit for you. How amazing is that? Amen. But he'll give grace only to the humble. Who is the humble person? A humble person agrees with the word of God. Doesn't agree with your circumstance, doesn't agree what the devil is telling, but will agree with the word of God. You know, I love to agree with the intercession that's going on in heaven. You know, he brought us into the new covenant today. It's such a beautiful and glorious covenant that we are in. We are no more in the old covenant. The old covenant is done away with, but we have a new covenant through the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. When we partook of communion today, we were saying, this cup is the new testament in my blood, Jesus said. And when you partake of that cup and say, I'm in the new covenant with my Lord Jesus Christ, what is really happening is there is intercession going on in heaven 24/7 on behalf of you and me. Jesus, my high priest, is praying for me. The blood of Jesus is speaking on my behalf from the mercy seat, Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 26. And if you can agree with that scripture, and if you can agree with the prayers that's going on there, first of all, it starts off by saying you're forgiven. If you're still guilty of your sins, you're not agreeing with that prayer. Next, it tells you you're righteous. If you don't confess that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, you're not agreeing with that prayer. Then it tells you you're sanctified, set apart for God's holy use. But if you don't think you're holy and you don't confess you're holy, you're the righteousness of God and you're sanctified, you're not agreeing with that prayer. That prayer is saying you're preserved in Christ. But if you're not agreeing with that prayer, you are saying you're frightened. What's going to happen to you tomorrow? You may have sickness, you may have disease, you may get into debt, you may come into curse. No, you agree with that prayer, because then Jesus, the high priest of our confession, is praying for us. Wow. You know what Jesus said at the tomb of Lazarus? He said, Father, you always hear my prayer. The reason I'm a winner today is not because of my prayers, but Jesus, the high priest of my confession. I love this. I love this so much. I'm not dependent on myself even for 1 second. I depend only on the Lord for everything. What do I have to do? I have to confess the word, that's all. What do I confess? I look at the word and say, Lord, this is who you are to me. You have given me, Lord, these Bible verses to stand on, to confess. You are my loving Father who's given me better things than what I can ever imagine. Yeah? So what do? I keep saying, Lord, I thank you. I thank you for the intercession that's going on in heaven. I thank you, Lord, for what you have done for me. It's just so amazing what the Lord has done for us. Amen? So Hebrews chapter 12 verse 24 says the blood is speaking on our behalf. But Hebrews 3:1, I want you to turn there to see what the Bible says about our confession. Our confession is very, very, very important. If you're confessing wrong things, Jesus cannot be the high priest of your confession. If you say, I'm sick, I'm broke, I'm disgusted, I'm sad, I'm fearful, I'm unhappy, or I'm bitter, I'm angry with somebody, God cannot be the high priest of your confession, because you're not agreeing with the blood that's speaking from the mercy seat. This word says, wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Jesus, the faithful high priest of our confession. So it's so important what we confess. You know what happened at the tomb of Lazarus again? Before Jesus reached the tomb of Lazarus, we always talk about Mary, who was sitting at the feet of Jesus and listening to the voice of the Lord, which is wonderful, which we should do. All of us should do every day. But look at the life of Martha for a minute. The reason why Lazarus rose from the dead, I believe, was because of Mary's confession of Martha's confession of who Jesus is. Look at this word in John chapter 11. I want you to look at this word and get so excited about it, because truly this is what brought about the miracle. John chapter 11 verse 21 tells us, this is what Martha said to Jesus. Verse 20 says, then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, 4 days after the brother had been put in the grave, she's telling him, but I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Wow, what faith she had in Jesus. 4 days in the grave, completely dead, even decomposed body. But she says, Lord, even now, if you pray to the Father, God will give you anything you are asking for. And what did Jesus say? Your brother shall rise. But she thought it was in the resurrection. She never thought it was in the now. So Jesus tells her, I am the resurrection and the life. He did not say this to Mary. He said this to Martha. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet he shall live. We are in that group. Amen? Are you excited you are in this group? Yes, you believe Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And then he went on to make the new covenant after rising from the dead. You know, he is the one who is the mediator of the new covenant. He's the one who's looking to see who will believe in the covenant I made for you. You know, communion is the token of the covenant, the body and the blood of Jesus in us. That makes us live like Jesus. That's what he said in John chapter 6, verse 56 and 57. We are united with the Lord through communion. His blood is flowing in every cell in my body. My blood is carrying his blood. My body has got his body. I'm united with the Lord and I'm one spirit with the Lord. I should have everything that Jesus has through communion. I should have his health, wealth, strength, peace, joy, every good thing, the love of God to flow into my life because of communion. Hallelujah. Are you excited? Really, this is the true bread that's come down from heaven for us to remove the lies of the devil from our lives and our hearts. It is the bread of life that satisfies, the bread of life that says you will never be hungry, you'll never be thirsty. Wow, it is the living bread that has come down from heaven to give life to the whole world. So we must look at this bread that we partake of with meaning in our heart, that this is what brings me into the new covenant. And the blood of Jesus is so powerful, is so powerful. It can drive out all the demons from your life. Amen? It can change your heart, give you a new heart and a new spirit, and really cause you to live in that place where God wants us to live. Yes, read John chapter 6, verse 32 to 52, 57, to really see what the Bible tells about believing in Jesus, believing in his body, believing in his blood, getting into the new covenant with meaning, and abiding in Christ all the time through this communion. It's a wonderful place to be in. But then what I want to tell you today is really, unless the Holy Spirit reveals it to you, you will never know. You may come to church every day, you may partake of communion every day, you may hear about the new covenant, you may hear about grace, but you will never receive any of the blessings that come from the new covenant because you don't have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. The most important person today on the earth, Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. We are seated in our spirits, in Christ, in heavenly places. But since we are also on this earth right now, we need the Spirit of God to reveal to us the mysteries from the Word of God. Unless you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, unless you are united with the Holy Spirit, unless you spend time with the Holy Spirit, unless you're baptized. For me, after I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, my life completely changed. The Word started talking to me as never before. And really, I came into such a close relationship with the Lord. I cannot live without reading the Word. I cannot live without praying in tongues, because when I pray in tongues, my spirit prays with the help of the Holy Spirit. And again, in Romans chapter 8, we will see it is Jesus who is interceding for us. So no one can condemn us. No one. Two out of the three in the Godhead are praying to the Father for us. How can we not be winners? Impossible for a Christian who comes to know that the Holy Spirit is praying through you, Jesus is praying for you, he's interceding by his blood from the mercy seat for you. You cannot but win. You cannot but win. You are winners all the time if you know who you are in Christ. But I want to show you one very interesting verse from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's go there. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 tells us we are new creatures in Christ. So anybody who is born again is a new creature in Christ. Say, I'm a new creature. Yes, get excited that you are a new creature. Old things have passed away. Old way of thinking, old way of talking, old way of living has gone away because you're a new creature in Christ. Old things have passed away and all things have become new in your spirit. And now your mind has to be renewed to make this come alive in you. What is it that I want to tell you today from 2 Corinthians chapter 5? I want to read from verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. I don't think we know that we have a ministry. Every one of us who's born again has a ministry. What is this ministry? Ministry of reconciliation. Reconciliation means we've been made to have peace with God. There is no more war between God the Father and you because of Jesus and his precious blood. So what is it I want to tell you? You have a ministry. The ministry of reconciliation. Let me read some more verses for you. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. You are in the world, and so are the rest of the people in the world. Our leaders of our nation, leaders of our city. You know, we may hate some people. We may not dislike the way they are behaving. But if you look at them as though they have been reconciled to God through the blood of Jesus. Let me read that word again. To wit, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, everyone in the world. And what did God do after that? Not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Why is India not saved yet? Because you and I are not praying this prayer that, Lord, you reconciled man to God through the blood of Jesus, through the work of the Spirit. And now we are calling Indians saved. We are calling our leaders saved. We are bringing them under the power of the blood of Jesus. We are saying they are forgiven. If you have any enemies today, you know, the Bible says love your enemies. You will have this test of faith to see if you are able to forgive them. If you're able to say, God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself and has given me the ministry of reconciliation, means what? Not only must I forgive that person, I must also bring them to Christ through my prayers. Whoever's hurting me, who's made me sad, who's robbed me, who's done harm to me, who's thinking bad of me, who's speaking bad of me, whatever they have done, if I believe this word that God has committed to me the ministry of reconciliation, and I need to take my ministry seriously, I need to pray for everyone who hurts me, I need to bless them that curse me, I need to love them that hate me. How do I do that? By looking at the blood of Jesus that was shed to reconcile the world unto himself. And also, he just didn't do that. Don't say that's his responsibility. He did it. No, he's given to us the ministry of reconciliation. How many of you say, I am going to really work on this? I am going to receive this ministry. I am going to really now, from now on, pray for those who hurt me. All the leaders of my country, I want to pray for their salvation. Jesus said, two people agree and pray, it shall be done by my Father in heaven. Two people agree and pray. Do you believe the word? It's the truth or it's lies? It's the truth. But we don't believe. We have so many doubts. You know, if there is doubt, then we are not in the law of the Spirit of life in Christ. There are five main laws in the new covenant. One is Romans 8:2. We are not in the law of sin and death, but under the law of the Spirit of life in Christ. We are under the law of faith. So if you're living in doubt, we cannot experience the law of faith. We are in the law of love, the royal law of love. If you're living in hate, we are really not living in the royal law of love. If you're not sowing, you cannot reap. It's another law in the Bible. Just like the law of gravity. If I fall from a 10-story building, I cannot fly up. I will only fall down. Same way, God has laws in his word. And if you get into those laws and you believe in those laws and you keep confessing those laws and live in those laws, it will produce the result God has promised in his word. But we should pray without doubting, Jesus said, and you will have whatever you say. So now let's be people who will believe this. Then next verse is even better. He says, now then we are ambassadors for Christ. Who are you and me? Ambassadors for Christ. You know, ambassador is a very important person. The ambassador of the U.S. who stays here owns that place. America owns the place where the U.S. consulate is. They have their flag running over there because it belongs to them. You know, Haiti is a very poor country next to the US. But when the US consulate goes there, I mean, the building there is so posh. It's so beautiful. You can see it even when you're going over that place. It's got a huge compound, completely white in color. It's beautiful. In that poverty-stricken land where the US embassy is so posh. Is so rich because it belongs to that country. We are now the ambassador of the US cannot do whatever he wants. He will do whatever the government wants. Now you and I are ambassadors of the kingdom of God. If we do whatever we want, will we still be ambassadors? No. We must know who we are. We are ambassadors of our Lord Jesus Christ and His kingdom on the earth. We must bring down His will. What is His will? Everyone to get saved, even through our intercession. He wants the whole world to get saved. He doesn't want even one person to perish. Doesn't want anyone to go to hell. But He's waiting on us, you and me, to have the ministry of reconciliation. So that, what is He saying here? Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you, by us we pray. You in Christ's stead to be reconciled to God. First of all, you yourself have to be reconciled to God. Must believe God is at peace with me. He's not at war with me. He's waiting to bless me. In Luke, Jesus said, you know, you who are evil know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more your Heavenly Father will give to them that ask Him for the Holy Spirit. Once the Holy Spirit comes into your life and you surrender to Him and you yield your members to Him according to Romans chapter 6, you will see a difference in your life. What is the difference? You will become an ambassador for Jesus. You will take on the ministry of reconciliation. You will know the blood of the cross has purchased my peace. The blood of the cross has set me free from all the anger that God had towards my sin. The blood of the cross has reconciled me with God. And now I'm no more in that place where God is angry with me. I'm reconciled to God. And now I remember verse 21, very important verse for each one of us. Now He hath made Him to be sin for us. Who is that? God the Father put all the sins of the world upon Jesus, His beloved Son. Why? He knew no sin, not even one sin He committed, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. So no more is God angry with us. No more is He looking at our sins. He's calling us reconciled to God because of the work of Jesus. And now He's calling us righteous with the righteousness of Christ. It's a gift from God. That's what I said. Everything is by grace through faith. Amen. The obedience of Jesus has purchased this for us. Every day I remember the obedience of Jesus on my behalf. And I thank God for it. And I say, thank you, Lord. You were willing to obey. It was so difficult for you to hang on the cross. Without clothes, without shelter, without water, without food, without anything. You took the poverty curse of which was to have been on me. You took it on yourself, Lord. You shed your precious blood, my Master, for me, a sinner. You called me now a saint of God. You brought me into that place where I'm a saint now by the precious blood of Jesus. No more a sinner, but a saint of God. Hallelujah. A king of God, appointed by God, an ambassador of Jesus, appointed by God. And you know what? The more you believe that the new covenant is working for you. I love this verse in Hebrews chapter 13. I want to share it with you. And if you have problems with your children, you have problems with your husband, problems in your workplace, problems where you're staying with your neighbors, wherever there is a problem, you need to confess this verse and come out of that problem. You know, first of all, you know, I have children and grandchildren. Some of them are youngsters. My son is not yet married. He's in America. And sometimes he does things which I don't approve of at all. But I call him forgiven. I call him sanctified. I call him in Christ. I call him under the blood of Jesus, perfected forever. I don't call him what I see in his life. I call what the Bible calls him. And you will see when you do that, you are really being an ambassador for Jesus. You're putting a smile on his face when you walk by faith in what he has done. And I speak this verse over my son. and also my granddaughters and all my children who are in their teen years, you know, I want them to really come into this place of reconciliation with God. I don't call them by what I see in their lives. I call them what the Bible calls them. It's a place of peace. It's a place of joy. It's a place of reconciliation. It's a place of glory. It's a place of mercy. It's a place of grace. I urge you, brothers and sisters, to really live in this place. Hebrews chapter 13, 20 and 21 says, now the God of peace. Again, this our God is a God of peace. You must know him as the God of peace. God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ. Again, it's the gospel. Always remember, always live in the post-resurrection era. You're not in the old covenant. You're not in the old era. You're not even in the gospels before the death of Jesus. You are in a place where Christ is risen from the dead. The power of the gospel is released into your life. You're not an ordinary person. You have Jesus, who's the risen Lord, living in you. You have glory inside of your spirit. Amen. So he's telling here, the one who raised up Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect. Say, thank you, Lord. I'm on the way of perfection. I'm on the way. My children, my grandchildren, my husband and I are on the way of perfection because of the blood of Jesus. It says here, through the blood of Jesus. See, it says here, let me read it again. That great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Can anything get better than this? Can anything be better than the will of God? You know, when you trust in the God of peace, when you trust in the blood of the everlasting covenant, when you trust in the fact that Jesus is risen from the dead, perfection is working in you. When you partake of communion, that blood is changing you. That blood is making you perfect to do his will, not my will. You know, nowadays everybody, even the children are taught, do what you want. No. When I go to Australia, that's their way of living. You know, my son-in-law and everybody, all the teachers and everybody, all the children are told, you do what you want. I said, no, you do what Jesus wants. You do what God wants, not what you want. There's no victory in doing what you want. The whole business about us being in Christ is, are you ready to say, Lord, not my will, but yours be done. But if you trust in the blood of Jesus, you know, it starts working. Not only in your life, but in your family. God is very interested in your family. Your wife, your children, your grandchildren, whoever is attached to you. The blood is working to make you perfect. To do that which is well-pleasing in the sight of the Lord. And all the good works God wants us to do. You know, we are masterpieces of our Lord Jesus Christ. Created for good works. Do you believe you're created for good works? If you don't have any good works still coming up your life, you should tell yourself, Lord, I thank you for the good works you want me to do. You will open the door for me to do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Because I trust in the blood, the everlasting covenant. The blood of the everlasting covenant is making me perfect, is giving me that peace, which I don't have right now. But I trust in your blood, Lord, to give me that peace, which you're talking about here. And the will of God, the perfect will of God. I don't want the permissive will of God. Father, I want the perfect will of God in my life. Perfect will of God, in short, is heaven on earth. Yesterday I spoke about it. And really, we must, all of us who are believers, must experience heaven on earth. Anything that's not in heaven, don't let it be in your life. If you come into the will of God, that's what God wants for each one of us. Amen. So really, I want to challenge you today. Who is willing to say, I'm an ambassador of Jesus? I want you all to stand up. I want to pray for you. You want to take your ministry seriously. Ministry of reconciliation. You're not going to be angry with anybody else in this world from today onwards. You're not going to have wars and fightings anymore. You're not going to argue with your husband or your wife. You're not going to be fighting with your children anymore. Doesn't matter what they're doing. You just say, they're forgiven by the blood of Jesus. You just say, they're reconciled to God by the power and the blood of Jesus. You just say, Lord, I thank you. You're bringing them into perfection because I trust in the blood that was shed from the cross of Calvary. sorry for them, Lord. I'm not here simply, I'm here. I'm in covenant, Lord. I'm in the blood covenant, Lord. And I want to take this very seriously. I want to take my ministry seriously. It starts with me. Does it start with anybody else? It starts with you. Are you willing to call yourself forgiven and call others forgiven and bring them into this ministry of reconciliation? Can you lift up your hands to the Lord and say, here I am. I thank you, Lord. I'm an ambassador of Christ. Thank you, Lord. You've given me the ministry of reconciliation after reconciling me with God. And you have also reconciled everyone in this world. You shed your blood for each and every one in this world. So we pray for our leaders in our country, though we don't agree with what the things they do. But we want to see, Lord, they are reconciled to God. They are forgiven. They are blessed. They are saved. They are under the blood. We bring them into the perfect will of God, the Father. And here we are, my Father. We want to pray for all those who hurt us, all those who curse us, all those who say bad things about us. We want to bless them. All those who cheat us, Lord, we want to bless them with the blessings of salvation. We want to bring the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ over them, the message of the cross over them. We call them delivered from the hand of the enemy. We call them delivered from the power of Satan. And help us, Holy Spirit, to live in the new covenant. We ask this prayer in Jesus' precious and matchless name. Amen.
What a powerful word this morning. Amen. Can we all just lift our hands and ask once again the Spirit of God to really speak to us and really help us to be declaring the Word of God, declaring whatever we learn today in our lives today. Come on, just allow the Spirit of God to just breathe it upon you once again today. Thank you, Spirit of God. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, the Spirit of God. Thank you, God. Come on, yes.
Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you won.
So God, we thank you, God, for you are our champion, oh God, and you call us, overcome us. You call us, Lord, more than overcome us, oh God. And we thank you, Lord, for that today. Even as we close, maybe you are here in this building, never received Jesus into your life. I want to give you this opportunity to receive him today. You know, everything that you heard about today starts by receiving Jesus into your life first. So as every eye is closed, if there is anybody in this building who says, I need to receive Christ into my life, I want you to just lift up your hand wherever you are. Just lift up your hand high. It's a decision you are making by asking Jesus to come into your life, asking him to wash your sins away. Anyone out there, just lift up your hands. I want to pray with you today. Thanks, us. Thank you. I see those hands. Thank you. And everybody's lifted up their hands. I just want to lead you in a small prayer, a prayer of faith. Nothing magical about this. A simple prayer of faith. Asking Jesus to come into our lives. And at Hope Unlimited Church, we believe in the family praying together. Come on, let's all pray this prayer out aloud with everyone who is praying for the very first time. Come on, let's pray this. Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your son Jesus to die for me on the cross of Calvary. Jesus, I realize I'm a sinner and I ask you to forgive me of all my sins and wash me with your precious blood. Jesus, I believe in you with all my heart and confess you with my mouth that you are Lord. Come live inside of me by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for everybody's making that prayer for the very first time, oh God. People rededicating their lives today, oh God, I pray that they'll have a greater understanding, greater revelation of your work in their lives, oh God. And we seal that decision by your Holy Spirit today, oh God. And the devil will not rob the joy of their salvation in any way. We thank you, Lord, for that today. And even as we go out of this place, oh God, we pray, Lord, that your peace and your presence go with us, oh God. May we learn to continue to live in your grace. Walk by your grace, oh God. And Lord, help us to be living our lives, bringing honor and glory to your holy name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Once again, thank you very much. I hope you have God deposited something in your life today. And if you made the decision to receive Jesus into your life, we want to help you out in your journey. So can I request you to go down to our fellowship hall, which in that fellowship hall, you'll find the prayer room. Please go inside the prayer room. One of our team members will be there to pray with you and help you on with your decision with Christ. And if you need prayer for any other requests you have, you can always visit our prayer room. And if you are here for the very first time, we have a special place for you called the guest lounge outside this building. Go there and meet one of our team members. God bless you. Church, have a great week.